Hello, everyone. One of the major tasks of the first International NASH Day is to inform and educate people about this quite unknown disease called NASH. In this final segment, we'll be reflecting on the future of research and treatment and the need to raise awareness. Donna Cryer, hello. You're the CEO of the Global Liver Institute, whose mission is to improve the life of those impacted by liver diseases. One of your goals is to encourage innovation and collaboration to help eradicate liver diseases. Yes. Professor Sanyal, hello.
Hi.
You're a world-famous hepatologist at the Virginia Commonwealth University in the United States. You've served as the president of the American Association for the Study of Liver Diseases, and you're also a specialist in NASH. Donna Cryer, how do you forecast the evolution of NASH in the future? Do you think that the disease is going to keep developing or not?
Well, unfortunately, along with rates of type 2 diabetes and obesity and other aspects of metabolic syndrome, we will see NASH and forms of fatty liver disease rise. You have to realize that almost 1 in 4 people around the world already have some aspect of fatty liver disease and NASH. It's just undiagnosed. So we can't address a problem until we acknowledge it. And that the fact that, there is such low awareness that we're not addressing this problem will only make it get bigger before it gets smaller.
When do you think that there will be treatments available for NASH patients, Professor Asano?
Well, we're very hopeful that the first set of drugs to be approved for NASH will be available probably in 2020, which is coming up on us fairly soon.
Will there be one magic pill type of treatments, or will it be like a more complex kind of treatment to cure it?
What's exciting for me, who has been a liver patient probably around the same amount of time that you've been practicing as a liver doctor, to see
because you've been like a liver transplant recipient.
Yes, yes, absolutely. So I was diagnosed with liver disease in my 20s, and so move forward several years, more than I'd like to admit. It's exciting now to see a level of innovation, to see many companies who are entering the space trying to develop drugs for NASH. And what we're likely to see, and Dr. Sanyal is right, it's going to be coming in this next 12, 18-month time frame. What we're likely to see are medications that address multiple factors of NASH. There's both an inflammatory factor and a fibrotic factor. So we'll probably not have one magic pill, but we might have one pill that makes an incredible difference on some factors, and there might be more than one that are ultimately prescribed to patients with lifestyle changes that will help reverse their NASH.
Okay, and Professor Sanyal, do you think that the treatment that will appear in the market will be enough to get rid of NASH?
The initial set of drugs that are being studied and are likely to be approved are focused on the front end of the disease, which is the metabolic disturbance, which leads to the injury, inflammation, and scarring. So technically, if you turn the tap off by fixing the metabolic end, everything else will cool down. That is probably enough for someone with early disease, where you have time, where the liver has a tremendous capacity to actually regenerate and heal itself.
How about if I am at the end stage of the disease?
Exactly. So when you're at the end stage of liver disease, that probably may or may not be sufficient because you don't have the time to take care of all the other processes that are leading you to end stage liver disease. You may need directly acting antifibrotic therapies or therapies that will reduce inflammation and scar in those patients.
So does it mean, Donna Cryer, that there is a question mark as to whether there will be treatments available for end-stage disease?
It's exciting that there's research in multiple phases along the spectrum, so we'll have to see where the science leads. But I think we need to be clear about the seriousness of all these stages. No amount of liver disease is benign, and I think that's the myth that's been perpetuated for too long, that, oh, someone just has a little bit of fatty liver disease. There's no such thing as benign liver disease. At the end of this, as Dr. Sanyal was talking about, end-stage liver disease can really mean liver cancer, can mean life or death, can mean you either get a transplant, of which there are far too few, or you die. So there are very serious consequences. I think along with the lack of awareness, when people do know about this disease, there's often belittling it, and we're really looking at avoiding these very serious life and death consequences.
I see. So one of the key issues regarding NASH is to raise awareness within society, but also within the community, the medical community, as you said. As a matter of fact, we interviewed Professor Newsome, who is the coordinator of a major international congress on liver disease. The most recent one was held in Paris a few months ago. So how such a gathering can help boost research and awareness? Let's listen to what he has to say.
So the European Association for the Study of the Liver, or EASL, has had a major impact on NAFL. And you see that at the meeting here, the International Liver Conference, which has over 10,000 delegates. Over the past two or three years, I've already seen significant changes. I think there's a greater awareness about the link between obesity and liver disease. I think you see a huge investment by industry in different clinical trials, which is really exciting. And I think more importantly, you're now starting to see governments changing legislation to try and change the environment and, you know, drive prevention of obesity and consequences such as NAFLD and NASH. I see the collaboration between the NASH Day and EASL being a very fruitful collaboration. One of the exciting things with the International NASH Day is that it brings together the full range of stakeholders, from patients to diabetologists to hepatologists, industry involvement, to really make a big impact. But after this first International NASH Day, going forward to the next one, what I hope we see is that this continues, the synergy between different organizations continues, because, you know, we have this collective goal, and it's only by bringing together the relevant stakeholders that we can impact on the various different levels of public policy, research, clinical pathways, and so on. I'm optimistic for the future in NAFL because I think we are getting things in place. We're getting the public awareness right. We're getting the care pathways sorted out. We're building the links with other clinical disciplines. And I think really excitingly, we're seeing a range of new therapies, some of which look really quite compelling, and which hopefully we can, you know, we can offer our patients in years to come.
Donna Cryer, do you think that NASH could be tamed or terminated one day?
One day, yes. You know, when you think about only 12 to 18 months before a new treatment, to be able to let people, the public, policymakers in Europe, in Washington, D.C., all around the world, in states, understand what are needed. It could be things like support for healthy lifestyle choices. It could be more health coaches. It could be better food in schools. It could be changes in the school curriculum, since so many young people, children, are affected by fatty liver disease and NASH. And so we really need to embed liver health and NASH education throughout the culture, throughout curricula, throughout our policies at every level, for people to be able to be successful and for the treatments, once they are developed, to reach people successfully.
So you're saying that government should be more involved in this, financially and politically speaking?
Well, third part, it depends. Every country is different, as right. You know. So where the people making the policies for access to care, who are third-party payers for healthcare, they need to step up to the plate, recognize the problem, and allow access to diagnostic and therapeutics for people who already have significant disease. That's the immediate need. In the intermediate term, we need policies to increase surveillance and understanding the impact on population health. One thing we have to realize, not only is the prevalence of disease going to increase, but the aging of the existing population is associated with increased exposure to the disease. So you will not only have more disease, but you'll have all the people who have early disease today, which is the majority of people who have the disease right. today.
Young people.
Young people. Mm-hmm. They will have advanced disease in 10 to 20 years. So many of today's children will be dying of what we originally thought was an old person's disease.
Mm-hmm. Donna Cryer just mentioned, yes. Food in school.
Yeah.
How mm-hmm. are you going to make sure that I do not buy and eat and drink, processed food, large portions, sugar, fat, etc., if I've got no other choice?
Well, one of the things is we've reached out to a lot of companies as well as the medical society. So I don't think it's about sort of mandating things. But I think once people are aware of the pervasiveness of these issues, they will start, as you've seen, more companies move towards food with lower sodium in response to the advocacy from the heart
sugar
community.
Sugar, it hasn't worked yet.
Well, we're working on that. I think, you know, NASH policy makes sense when you think about, even in the U.S. alone, there are $100 billion, billion with a B, of direct medical costs already. So it's an economic problem as well as a you know, moral and ethical issue to help support people with this. And so I think as we increase the understanding of that, as we analyze the problems, we need both changes in medical policy, and that would be the screening and making sure that people had coverage for the screening, as well as coverage for the treatments while they're being monitored, imaging and the like, as well as then really treating this from a 360-degree perspective as a public health solution.
Do you agree with that?
Yes. And so one stakeholder who's missing in action is the food industry. And just as we held the tobacco industry accountable for what they provide to the public, we need to hold the food industry also accountable for the nature of the food that is provided in our grocery stores.
Okay, as part of the first International NASH Day, many events are taking place to raise awareness on the severity of NASH, and more artists are getting involved. We met one of them whose message is visible right down the streets to strike the hearts and minds of the younger and urban generations.
With their sedentary lifestyle and exposure to junk food, urban populations and teenagers are particularly at risk of developing NASH. So to make them more aware, Paris street artist Provoxer has armed himself with spray cans.
On va faire un travail d'équipe, c'est-à-dire que je vais vous faire la base des lettres. Vous allez m'aider à faire un remplissage à l'intérieur. On va écrire en gros le mot NASH, d'accord? Il va y avoir dans le fond de la référence à la malbouffe. On va faire une chaussure qui va venir écraser en fait le NASH pour dire qu'il faut se bouger un peu.
The mural they'll be painting together will help other urban youngsters learn more about a little-known disease.
Vous avez jamais entendu parler de la NASH?
La plupart des jeunes ne connaissent pas cette maladie.
L'intérêt d'écrire NASH sur le mur, c'est pour sensibiliser les jeunes, pour faire comprendre les impacts de la malbouffe.
L'art, je pense, a toujours été un bon moyen de sensibiliser le public. C'est quelque chose qui attire l'œil. Donc, si on peut aider la maladie de NASH, on va dire, à se faire connaître via ce moyen artistique, pourquoi pas, c'est pour ça qu'on est là aujourd'hui.
And as Provoxer has developed a large influence on social networks, his mural will be widely shared by his friends and followers.
Je pense que les réseaux sociaux combinés à l'art sont un très bon moyen de faire connaître cette maladie au milieu des jeunes. Les gens vont se dire qu'est-ce que c'est NASH, pourquoi NASH.
In any case, these youngsters seem to have the answer to this question. The message has clearly gotten across.
Pour combattre la NASH, faites du sport.
Moi, j'ai équilibré.
Le 12 juin, c'est la première journée internationale de la NASH.
How critical is it to get young people to raise awareness about NASH?
Well, it's so important to involve young people in these discussions around fatty liver disease and NASH because their health is at stake, but also because they have an incredible energy and creativity about this. And so as we work to do education, it's important to have this as part of music, part of magazines and publications the young people read. Have this online, have this very active in social media. That will really be essential to changing people's hearts, minds, and their behaviors so they can prevent NASH, or if they're in the early stages, hopefully to address it.
Professor Sanyal, you have the final word. What do you hope in the future for the fight against NASH?
Well, I hope that there are societal changes with respect to our culture of behavior, with respect to food, exercise, activity, sleep, etc., so that we live a metabolically more healthy life.
And bringing all the stakeholders, as you said, government, food industry,
exactly,
medical community.
So that as a society, we are more healthy. So there's a preventive component to the whole problem. But there are people where the preventive aspects will not work. They will still get the disease because they are genetically predisposed or there are other factors that may be in play. So for them, we hope we will have personalized medicine, where we will know exactly what the drivers of their disease progression are in terms of molecular pathways, so we can target those pathways with very specific drugs. Not that dissimilar for what is already happening in the cancer field, where specific molecular signatures of the disease
Tailor-made.
have already been identified to identify which therapy will work best for which patient.
How about you, Donna Kern? What's your wish for the future?
So 1 year after the first International NASH Awareness Day, I hope that people are talking about NASH, that they know when we talk about it, when we say the word, they know what it is and they know how important it is to their own health.
Will you be among us for the second International NASH Day in 2019?
Absolutely.
Hey, you bet.
All right. Thank you all for joining us for this last program. Thank you, Professor Sanyal. Thank you, Donna Kreyer. You can find all our programs on the disease in this website. This is First International NASH Day is making itself heard because NASH is still a disease we know very little about, and awareness has to be spread around. Thank you.